talk about this and much more. White House counselor to the president, Kellyanne Conway. Kellyanne, thanks so much for being with us. Appreciate it.
It's nice to be with you, John, and congratulations on your new assignment.
Very nice of you to say. Kellyanne, are you still an Eagles fan?
Of course. I'm so thrilled that the Philadelphia Eagles won Super Bowl 52. Lifelong fan, born in Camden, New Jersey, over the river, married in Philadelphia, season ticket holder. And, you know, I'm old enough to remember sitting out at Veterans Stadium season after season when they didn't do so well. And I went to the Super Bowl against your Patriots in 2005 and went this year as well. And I'm very happy. I'm very happy that the Eagles won the Super Bowl. And I'm very happy that yesterday here on the South Lawn, hundreds and hundreds of Americans joined the president in celebrating America. I think both things can be applauded.
I like the 2005 result better. Let me just stipulate that. Kellyanne, just so I understand the president's position, he says it is unpatriotic for players to kneel during the national anthem, even though no Eagles kneel during the anthem during the regular season or playoffs last year.
Right, so let's not conflate a couple different things here. Let's unpack that separately. The president has made clear for about a year now, almost a year now, John, that he believes it's a very simple request to have everybody standing for the national anthem, hand over heart, celebrating all that the flag stands for. Separately, the president sees that the NFL came out with its own policy. If you read the NFL policy, and I have, I've practically memorized it, that is a condition of employment they're making on their players and their clubs. That has nothing to do with the White House and the president. It just seems like they have a similar agreement on if you're on the field, you must stand for the national anthem. The NFL has said as recently as 2 weeks ago.
To be clear,
they said that if you're out there and you're not standing, the team will be fined. You don't need to be out there. You can be in the locker room.
And to that last point, the president has also suggested very recently that being in the locker room is not enough. Staying in the locker room is unpatriotic. Is that his position?
Well, you like to use words like unpatriotic, like you like to use other words that don't describe accurately the state of mind or state of play. So I will push back on that. But I think the president has made a very simple request. He has just said that he believes you should stand for the flag and honor all that it means. That is different from what happened here. What happened here is that I think because of this new NFL policy, folks are digesting it. Has nothing to do with us. Mm-hmm. Folks are digesting that. And the Eagles had already sort of set in dozens and dozens of officials and players to come for the celebration. And then that number was reduced. And the president decided he didn't want to. The number that he focused on is the number of Eagles fans who had already been waved in and secured here to come to the White House. He didn't want to disappoint them. We were told many of them were already in town. So rather than doubly disappoint Eagles fans, the president decided that they were all still invited, those who wanted to and could still come, and to celebrate America. And I think it's very fitting. The night before that, the president, the first lady, honored the Gold Star families,
and that was a
those families
that
who
was
have made, and today
event.
Is D-Day. So if we want to talk about
the president
of the
has
military,
the president has
we can
yet
do
to
that.
Comment. The president, by the way, has yet to comment on D-Day. I'm sure he will at some point today, but often by this time he's commented on the Russian investigation or other things.
But John,
things.
the issues that attend to those who are perhaps protesting in their own way, the national anthem. We can talk about those issues here at the White House. We've given so many different individuals and issues a platform, a hearing, a roundtable discussion, legislation, regulation. In other words, this is a very open White House
But in this instance, Kellyanne, the president is telling athletes the way he believes they can and can't raise objections.
No, the NFL is saying that.
Okay, but the president told the NFL that they should get those SOBs off the field. That's how this started with them. Last year he did, and then this year he said in a Twitter statement yesterday or the day before that it's not enough just to stay in the locker room. He is saying in his mind, you've got to go out, you've got to stand up, you've got to put your hand over your heart, as you just said. He is saying what he thinks they have to do.
And the problem with the president of the United States and the commander of chief expressing that opinion is exactly what? The NFL has its own opinion. Some players have their own opinions. And I think that you haven't given enough coverage to, respectfully, the number of Eagles players who do stand there with their hand over the heart, and the number of Eagles players who voted for Donald Trump.
I'm sure there are Eagles players.
Let alone the fans.
And Nick Foles wanted to come to the White House. We've made that clear over the last day. This is the issue of who gets to decide what is patriotic. And some people are making light of the fact. It is in a way, because the president has said it doesn't honor the troops. That's patriotism. The president has said that. So he is deciding what he thinks is patriotic. And there are people who've looked at him yesterday not singing along with God Bless America. And that may seem trite, but there are others who say, look, maybe it's not patriotic enough if you don't sing all the words to God Bless America. Who's
I saw your earlier segment, and I think it's a little bit, speaking of unseemly, you didn't need to write that segment, that chyron, the way you did, but you like to. There's a lot of snark and bark coming toward us at this White House. I think it's unfortunate, but if it's the only time today that God and America are in a chyron on CNN, I guess we'll take it. But the fact is, John, that this president, he is the commander-in-chief. Mm-hmm. He makes decisions every day that affects people's lives, including, if not particularly, in the military. He takes very seriously the sacrifice that tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of people have made, some of them the ultimate sacrifice over time.
And of course,
and
this
doesn't
is
think,
D-Day.
By the way, and I just want to make very clear, John, yes, it is D-Day. I mentioned that.
Yep.
And talk about, real heroes. John.
Well, can I just say,
this is very simple. The president is not telling the Philadelphia Eagles, the NFL, or any of us what to wear, what to think, how to be, how to spend your charitable time, what to do in the off season. He's basically making a very simple request that when the national anthem is played at a sporting event, people stand and people respect that. And I know everybody's saying, but nobody kneeled, nobody. There obviously are some hurt feelings over the new policy.
He did say staying in the locker room was not enough. He is telling people how to behave during that time. I want to move on to a subject. Here's the thing is that another aspect of this is we're talking about this to an extent because of what the president is saying about it. And we're not talking about the economy.
The president isn't
when he's talking about the anthem, and you're not right now. So I want to ask you about the economy.
Well, I'm not talking about the economy because I'm on CNN, and you don't talk about the economy.
Yeah, we did the jobs numbers when they came in. We had Stephen Moore, the economic advisor to the campaign, on to talk about how good those numbers were.
He's a smart guy, and I'm glad you had him on. But you should be, respectfully, you should have screaming graphics about lowest unemployment rate ever for African Americans, for Hispanics, for teens ever or within the last 18 or 19 years, for women. The job seekers, the job creators, and also the job holders have all benefited from this president's leadership. Mm-hmm. We have 6.7 million available jobs right now, John. That is a historic number. It's an incredible number.
It's a lot. It's a big number. The Wall Street Journal reporting today. The number is actually more than the people looking for jobs, which is
right.
The first time since 2000. That's a
that's
great
right.
number,
which
too.
Which means that job security and job availability go hand in hand.
Job creation numbers at the end of the Obama? You've created an average of $185,000 a month since you've come into office. The Obama administration, the last 16 months, 215. Were those numbers as good in your mind?
Well, John, was that the lowest unemployment rate among African Americans, Hispanics, and 19 years for women? No, of course not.
But it was headed that way. I'm just talking about job creation.
No, it wasn't headed that way. But it's the second time this hour you've mentioned President Obama. President Trump is in the White House now. He's here. And he, over the last year, has made economy that is booming. The confidence numbers alone, consumer confidence, small business formation confidence, manufacturers. You had his opponent in the presidential race, whose name I don't say on TV anymore, who lost, you had her promising to put the coal mining industry out of work. Mm-hmm. And this president has actually presided over a net creation of mining jobs, jobs in timber, jobs in manufacturing, over 300,000 new manufacturing jobs, over 337,000 new construction jobs. You can't argue with those numbers. And by the way, nobody should argue with them.
We're not arguing. We're having you on to talk about them.
But the president goes further than that.
They're very good.
Let me just say,
because of the president's trade policy, the Business Council yesterday said readjusted their job creation forecast down 13%. So there are numbers both ways, but the numbers are very, very solid, Kellyanne. I'm going to run out of time with you, and I want to get to a few more topics because we're lucky to have you this morning. Why doesn't Kelly Sadler work at the White House anymore?
So I spoke with Kelly Sadler last night, and she no longer works on this complex, and there are a number of open positions throughout the administration for those who wish to submit for them, interview for them. And I think that they match up nicely with different individuals' press and communication skills. In addition, I know that Kelly Sadler had a career in the private sector before she came to serve.
Is it because of what she said? Is she no longer working at the White House because of what she said about John McCain?
I literally cannot comment on personnel issues, and I wasn't involved with this specifically, but I will tell you that she no longer works here, and I talked to her.
Is she going to work in the administration? Are there other administration jobs open to her?
Yes, there are other administration jobs open to her, and to others who would like to interview for those jobs, they should definitely submit their credentials.
So in your mind, the comments she made about John McCain would not be disqualifying for another administration job?
I didn't say that. What I said is that she, as I understand it, has been provided with opportunities, the idea that there are opportunities throughout the administration that would fit with different skill sets. Okay. But you know, we're also very happy, again, that 6.7 million jobs are available to Americans all across the country, and that this president has invested considerably in workforce development and apprenticeship programs, because that will help people to choose all types of careers. This president said over a year ago that we dignify all types of
careers. To be clear, you're not closing the door to an administration job because of what she said about John McCain, pure and simple, correct?
Kelly Sadler has been told that there are administration jobs that fit with her skill set and her experience, and that the rest is really her choice of what she would like to do next.
Well, it's the government's choice. It would be the administration's choice to rehire somebody who said those things about John McCain. That you can't argue with, right?
John, you've litigated that many times over the last, I think, month or so.
This is the first time that she doesn't have a White House job, but apparently is going to have other opportunities within the administration.
I'm going to leave that up to her and her future employers. And I don't feel comfortable commenting on personal and personnel at the same time when the individuals involved are not here to speak about it. But again, we're diverting because that's what you do when there's a lot of great news.
We're trying to cover as much news as we can, Kellyanne, in the short period of time. And again, we're lucky to have you here. Sarah Sanders yesterday refused to address the comment she made last August, where she says the president did not dictate the letter to the New York Times, or to the comment to the New York Times about what happened at Trump Tower. You know, did the president dictate that?
I don't know. I wasn't there. And the first I heard of that memo was when I read it in the New York Times. Talk about a big leak, by the way.
Hope Hicks was there, though, on that plane. There were other administration officials. And Jay Sekulow, the president's lawyer, now says quite clearly the president did dictate it. Sarah Sanders said he did not dictate it.
Right. And everything that you're asking me has to do with outside counsel. And the reason that that's important here is that at the White House, we are pretty much walled off from the outside matters, because the president is represented by outside counsel, and you should really ask them. I know CNN
asked Jay Sekulow. Jay Sekulow has told us he stands by the letter, which says that the president did dictate it. It's not a outside counsel issue when Sarah Sanders says it from the podium, though. She said it from the podium. The president did not dictate it. The lawyer now says that the president did. So there's a difference there. Does Sarah need to explain to us why she said what she said?
I'm going to repeat what Sarah said to you, to the press who asked yesterday, which is that she is referring it to outside counsel. And that's where it needs to be left. I mean, this is an active investigation.
Does it need to be an outside counsel? Is she in legal jeopardy? Do you think she's in legal jeopardy for what she said?
Who?
Sarah.
No, I would have, no. Why are you saying
that? Is someone in legal jeopardy for what she said? Because you're saying it's a legal issue.
No. I'm saying that you're talking about something that the president's lawyer said. So by definition, is a legal issue, not a legal issue.
I'm talking about something that Sarah said on television.
No, I'm talking about, and Sarah addressed this, and you should go back and look at her comments.
Sarah said she won't address it, is what she said.
No. She addressed this yesterday. She addressed the matter yesterday. But I think on this, everything that has to do with what the president refers to as the Russian investigation, the hoax, the witch hunt, you should go back and look at his many tweets on the issue. You should go back and look at what he said as recently as yesterday, or the day before, John, is that he feels like a lot of people's lives are being ruined. Nothing has been produced that implicates the president in any way. And you know that. And you know that it would have leaked if that were there. You know that. I know that CNN has invested considerable sweat equity, time and money in chasing the Russian collusion, delusion, illusion. and that you're waiting for it to bear fruit. But a year in, you see the polls starting to turn on this. You saw the Harvard-Harris poll last week. You've got many Americans questioning.
Kellyanne, we do have to let you go. Let me just say nothing's been produced. There have been indictments against Russians, right? There have been guilty pleas by people who worked for the campaign.
I'm sorry, but do you have any evidence, seriously speaking, since you want to talk about the law to a fully recovered attorney, happily so, do you have any evidence that there was Russian collusion? Do you actually think it changed the election results? I haven't seen the special counsel's report.
I have seen evidence that Donald Trump Jr. met at Trump Tower with Russians promising dirt on Hillary Clinton. I have seen evidence that there were things that were lied about after that meeting, including whether the president dictated a letter. Someone lied about that.
You like to say that, but are you concerned that this IG report about the way the Clinton investigation was handled is delayed? Are you concerned about the content, or is CNN going to say, "Oh, she lost"?
I don't know. The only way I know it's delayed is because the president has suggested he's concerned about it, which suggests to me that he's perhaps being briefed by the Justice Department about the progress of this independent, the Inspector General's investigation. Is there something about that investigation you want to tell us? Over a year,
and all the compliance and cooperation hasn't diverted this president from doing his job. We are more prosperous, more secure 503 days or 2 days into his presidency. Hold on. And I don't think, frankly, respectfully, I don't think this has helped CNN. Your ratings are way down.
I know I hit a nerve there, John, but let's be fair.
You like to say lie and the president, Sarah, in the same sentence. Excuse me. This is not benefiting you. You're not getting new viewers who want to hear this junk and this bunk because you don't have proof and you're trying to let your viewers think that this man was not elected fairly and squarely. You know he was. You know not a single vote was changed. You do give that woman a platform when she comes. What are the Clintons doing to help America, by the way? What are they doing? You're giving her a platform.
I didn't ask about Hillary Clinton. All I was asking, Kellyanne, is about what the truth is here. And I appreciate you coming on again to make your case.
John, do you have any evidence that a single vote was impacted?
I don't know. There are investigations going on right now, and we will find out what the special counsel has to say, pure and simple.
John, excuse me, respectfully, do you think there is any part of that investigation that will show that this impacted votes and swung an election to Donald Trump? You know the answer is no. I know what we've been told so far. We haven't promised anything, Kellyanne, and this is a silly discussion now. I don't know. I will wait for the special counsel. I was a campaign manager for the winning part of the campaign. I never met Carter Page. I never talked to a Russian. I never talked to a Russian that I knew about. Maybe they were disguised as a voter in Wisconsin,
Kellyanne,
but I kind of doubt it. I mean, come on, this president won fairly and squarely. We got to go. We got to end it here because we're not getting anywhere on this. Thanks for covering the jobs numbers.
Again, the jobs numbers are good for the country, Kellyanne. Thank you for being with us. We'll talk again when the special counsel reports come out. Let's talk again, and we can discuss what it finds.
I'll be here. Thanks.
Allison.
Kellyanne wanted to keep talking.
I know.
Sometimes she doesn't want to, but that time she wanted to keep talking to you.
I'm very likable.
Are you?
No.
Yes, you are, John. America.